So yesterday I went to a barber battle with my lady. I took her with me. It was just me and her. Yesterday was Memorial Day. Today is Tuesday. I don't work today, so I'm taking the day off. It's kind of a short week for me this week because I'm going to be heading out of town at the end of the week. So Friday is my birthday. Big 49. 49 for all you guys that don't know what that is. 49 years young. This is what it looks like. Just kidding. But I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about yesterday's barber battle. So yesterday we went to the People's Championship Barber Battle. It's second annual. It was a small battle that they do right here in Orange County, in Anaheim. I didn't go for the battle. I didn't go to battle this time because you guys know that I battle sometimes on, I do the bigger show. I do it once a year. You know, I like to go out there and show my skills off too. But yesterday we just, I wanted to focus on the educational part. The MC was a gentleman named It's Marvy Marv, at It's Marvy Marv, if you guys check him out on Instagram. He's a guy that's, you know, he has a big name in the industry, and he has a lot to offer, and his brand is Barbers. It's awesome. You know, every time you hear it, it reminds me of him, and it's a great brand. And basically, yesterday's educational classes were one of them was all about branding and getting yourself on a social network and making sure that people see you and how to get seen. It was very, very interesting. Basically, what I'm explaining to you is a video that I'm going to show you guys right now because I didn't get a really chance to film an intro or an outro. But what I did is I'm just going to explain a little bit of what was going on there, and it's up to you if you guys want to watch it. I'm going to show you guys. It's kind of a long it's going to be a long vlog because I'm showing you guys everything that I filmed at the show. And I filmed things that I thought were kind of important. So if you guys want to watch it, it's up to you. It's really interesting. The first person that did a haircut tutorial, her name is Pope the Barber. She's a female barber from Orange County. Really good barber. She showed some little skills and stuff like that I thought were very interesting. But other than that, what I thought was really interesting was just her attitude and the way she presented herself and the way the passion that she has for our industry. To me, that's what amazed me. And you know, these guys that we went to go see were still young, you know, like way younger than me. So the second person that went up there was two gentlemen, brother barbers. One of them is Edwards Clipperhand. You guys probably, if you guys are on Instagram and YouTube, you probably know who they are. And then the other brother was named, his name is Fade Master. Both of these guys, I've seen them around plenty of times. When I go to other barbers battles, they're always there. Sometimes these guys host them because they're well known. They got thousands of likes on Facebook and followers. I mean, on Facebook, on Instagram. So they're very, very popular barbers. The last guy that was there, his name was Tyreek Jackson, and he was a motivator, and he's kind of a motivator, platform artist. He's a educator. He owns his own barber school in Pennsylvania. I got a chance to talk to him a little bit before he actually went up there and spoke, and I told him about my dreams and my wishes of being a barber school owner. You know, that's my dream, is to open a barber school. So I got to pick his brain a little bit before that, and he led me in the right direction, opened up my mind a little bit. He was a little sarcastic a little bit about it, but it was cool though, because he opened up my eyes. Like, there's the first step I got to do is get my instructor's license. You know, and I'm here, I'm thinking about opening a barber school, and I don't even have an instructor's license yet. So I got to get on that, and you know, if I'm going to make these goals happen, then I got to start doing my footwork and my things to get to where I want my company to be at, or my brand to be at, you know. But, you know, it was a very, very educational class, and talked a lot about branding and stuff like that, and that's what I like to watch. I like to listen to stuff like that. So, I'm gonna play the video for you guys and just watch the educational classes. They were very, very interesting. But there's gonna be no outro after that's over. I'm just probably gonna close out this video and we'll go from there, and I'll see you guys on Thursday. Mates.
So this is my second time actually in Cali, so you know I'm real excited to be out here. I don't really get this nice weather. I get about probably 2 good months of weather. It's nice, and then it's either too hot or it's too cold. So it's not all that great. So when I get out here, I get all happy. I'm in a good mood, and nothing brings me down. So I'm excited to be out here. I'm looking forward to the show. We got some really quality educators, so I hope you guys are ready for that. My advice to all of you would be to make sure you are taking notes, make sure you record it, like this man is right here,
yeah.
Like this man is with the notes, make sure you're taking it, because our minds are only going to remember so much. So you're going to see some things that are like, all right, that's dope, then you're going to be inspired, then you're going to go home in the shop, and you're going to be inspired, but you ain't going to remember what the hell you was inspired for. So my advice to all of you would be to take notes. So the first person we're going to have come up, you ready? You ready to do this? Shut it down? For me to shut up? So you get up here? We keep going? So the first person we're going to come up here is Pope the Barber from Atori Hanzo. So Pope the Barber is going to do her thing. So put your hands together and make sure you're paying attention. Take your notes. Send it out to barbers. Watch your motherfucking show, man.
They let me be the artist that I want to be, and they just basically enhance my life. You know, some companies will sit there and, you know, you, like I said, use you for their gain. And you know, when you're looking for companies, you really need to see, you know, sit down and know what your worth is, you know, in terms of pay and time and all of that. But it's a long day. I'd love to talk to you later about that. But yeah. If you can't wake up in the morning and love what you're doing and be excited about what you're getting paid for, then, you know, don't work. Don't do it. That goes for being behind the chair and all that too. Charging what you need to be charging, what you want to be charging, and just being happy about what you do. You know, everybody has a gift in this room. You know, everybody is blessed enough to love something, and you know, you should be repaid for it for sure. In terms of getting the jobs and all that, like I always say, you know, like I have sponsors and, you know, I work for certain companies, but either they're chasing after you or, you know, it does not hurt at all to go and send them an email and say like, here, this is what I'm about, this is what I want to do. I've done that for a lot of the clothing brands that I rep, you know, like anything that I wear pretty much, like I'll just reach out, or they'll end up reaching out because I'm tagging them or anything like that, but it's all a game right now. And use it wisely. I don't know if I'm really supposed to be talking about all this, but this is what I feel like talking about today, all right? I don't know. It's like, cool, I just want to get to the real shit. You know, like, I hate coming to these things because, I mean, I love it, but, no, I mean, seriously, because everybody's just, like, trying to put on a show or whatever, like, you know, I want to get to the real root of, like, why am I here, you know? So let me answer one more question, and then we'll get on. Anybody else? I knew it was time to open up my shop when, you know, for a lot of us, we didn't go to school. I didn't go to school. I knew that I wanted to extend my brand through something. A lot of people like to, you know, a lot of barbers nowadays, they go that selfish route, which is all good. You know, you want to do it for yourself. You want to, you know, take it so far by yourself, which is so great. You know, I know a lot of barbers that are gonna go super far, but I think I wanted to extend a legacy, I suppose, and I knew by creating my brand, I was. Just so it's not completely bulbous the next time he comes back in about 2 months, right? Of course, you can't change the shape of, you know, the hair in 2 months. You completely lose that, you know, but yeah, anyway, so shape of the face, he's got a little oval face, which is nice. He'll look good with anything. A lot of the cuts are pretty similar nowadays in terms of what you're doing on the sides and top. Really what makes the haircut is what happens around the parietal, right? If you're leaving more weight, you know, you have to have kind of a motive to the whole surrounding haircut, right? So more weight on the corners, that's either gonna be like a blowout or you know, a side part. You need to use that cushion for the push-in, you know what I'm saying? So. Like I said, I'm going to leave a little bit less on the corners here. So it can turn really quickly into like a faux hawk, a mohawk, or, you know, anything like that. But yeah, we really have to stay conscious of what's happening around that parietal area. So that also comes into figuring out what type of fade we're doing, okay? Low, medium, or high. The lower the fade, the more you want around the parietal. Right, and the, you know, some people like that look more so when you're when they're used to the taper or anything like that, when they're there more often. But since he's not going to be here he's not going to be in a shop so often, I'm going to pick a little higher of a fade because that's kind of taking out that parietal weight more so. You guys get it? Cool. Okay, so I'm going to start like that. I'm actually going to clear a little space first. And then I'll come back and I'll show you how I do what's called notch fading, which is the easiest 101 way to start fading from zero or like a baby butt smooth. So I'm just gonna clear some space right now. It'll take a couple seconds and then I'll cut to the next thing. Thing.
Head, marking it all up. Let the machine do the work. Now, why are you leaving all of this hair? What's the reason you do that?
It does bug a lot of stylists that, you know, we leave the hair on the bottom, but for me, it's time saving. I like to get straight into the fade. So, a lot of people like to clear this space immediately, which is cool, but sometimes when I'm doing like a straight razor shave at the end, I know exactly what I'm shaving off. So like I said, I'm leaving this base length right here, and then from there, that under, like right underneath this length is going to be whatever my T-liner is. So it's going to be a length a little bit shorter, and then that's going to go into that baby butt smooth. So it just depends on what you're doing. I like to leave that, like I said, just to leave a marker of what I want to be baby butt skin.
So pretty much he's saving some time. And time is money in this profession. Notice how she's making sure it's even on both sides. One side ain't way up and the other one way low. Fade leaning, it's even. And the baby brush is key, guys. If you don't got you that brush right there, that brush is key. That's the secret. That's the secret to the flawless fade, the baby brush. Now she opened the guards, completely open. It's a half. Well, that's what I call it, a half. You guys call it a half, same thing? Call it open, 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 close.
Alright, so what I'm doing right now is I'm basically clearing space for myself. I'm doing the same thing I did kind of before with the two, where I'm clearing that space, but there's still motive to how I'm clearing it. So I'm doing soft guidelines. I have the clipper completely open, which is not a perfect blend, obviously, from completely closed. So what I'm gonna be doing is called notch fading. So I'm gonna break up my clipper into four. There are no notches on the blade, obviously, but it's already closed, already open, so I put one, four. Now I just need to go back and do two and three. You guys get it? Okay, so basically I've gone almost an inch up, all the way open. Now I'm gonna go back and do two and three. I'm gonna go fade all the way up in each little increment and about an inch wide, okay? And the reason why I do it like that is, there are a lot of lumps and bumps in this area, and this is probably the most detailed area that you're going around the head with. Instead of, kind of uniform, you know, going around the head in uniform, I like to just dig out all the holes immediately. So each little part of this is kind of, as you can see right here, he has kind of a dip. You know, after the haircut, you typically have to kind of go back and dig that hole out. But since I'm notch fading now, it's kind of, I'm detailing to those certain little areas, right? You guys get it? Cool? No? You guys don't get it? Okay, I'll just show you.
Make sure you guys invest in some seniors as well. They're very quality clippers. If you can get the cordless ones, get the cordless ones too. Don't be cheap when it comes to your equipment.
Cross-check with yourself. You know, I'll put the shortest part of the comb, the longest part of the hair, and you're basically marrying the two lengths, you know. So it's really important just to, you know, if you're not sure how to position your hands, flat up against the head and pull out to where you see there needs to be hair being removed. So like I said, motive. There's all motive. I need a little bit of weight on the parietal, not too much, but that's why I'm not going straight up, okay? It's very important just to marry the two lengths that you have going on. Okay, you guys get that? Cool.
How many of you guys are students? 5 years or younger. Is that something you would advise?
Yes, I really, really advise seeing a chiropractor, honestly. I can see one once a week. He snaps my ass back into shape. It's really nice. Like, I had, you know, car accident, all this stuff, and standing on your feet all the time. It's just, I mean, everybody holds, you know, all their weight in their shoulders, especially when they're cutting, they're leaning over. Like, I am so bad at that. Like, I won't use my chair pump at all. I'll either do something stupid like this or like my neck pump, you know. But it's really important, especially if you're not correcting yourself. Go get your back cracked, you know. It's really important. Take care of yourself, babe.
Yeah, put a couple dollars a day away for that. You figure out how much it costs to do it once a week, once every other week, once a month, and put that money away. You guys make it, you have it, you're spending it on dumb shit. So put a couple dollars away and go see the chiropractor.
It's a weird looking blow dryer.
It's a blow dry stylus. They're dope. I love it. Because I'm an also grabber. Like, I've always done this anyway, so.
I've never seen that. Do you have it on hot or cold?
Hot, high.
Hot, high. Why do you have it on hot, high?
For time, you know, the more heat, you know, the straighter the hair is going to get without frizz. I like to start in the front. A lot of people like to start in the back, but just like doing women's hair or anything like that, you want to get the fringe dry first. Especially if they have curly hair and you're trying to make it straight, it's important to, you know, if girls have bangs, they want to get that first so it doesn't kink up before, you know, the rest of the hair dries and stuff, you know. So I like to at least get that dry first and then go back and kind of do the perimeter of the hair.
You guys own a round brush like that? You guys own that? Who doesn't own one of those? A couple of you guys are lying to me right now. I like that smooth like this. What's the key to using that? Because it can be difficult for somebody, because I know there's 1, 2, 3, maybe 10, 20 people that don't use that won't admit it right now. What's the key to using that brush effectively?
A lot of tension, you know, definitely getting to the root of the hair and brushing up. It's really important. Just learning, you know, it's hand-eye coordination. It's just like holding your comb or whatever it is. It's like, you know, you just have to kind of get used to the motions of doing that, you know, having an idle hand. And like I said, it's like what hand is going to mess up your haircut or actually determine, you know, what you're doing with the hairstyle, you know. So get to the root, blow dry up, a lot of tension is good.
So she rolls it into the hair, pulls it straight up. Rolls it in, pulls it straight up. And it's drying on high heat. Don't be scared to go in with your hands. See the way she goes in with her hands? getting it nice and dry. Use your fingers.
This actually takes about 50% of the hair off, which is a lot. So the 40T, is the typical barber, or I mean, all of the thinning shears that you actually see are about the 40T is a lot of teeth, right? Great for blending, great for removing a little bit of weight. But these, you actually have to have a lot of motive behind it, you know, or else you're either taking too much hair out or whatever it is. So I'll teach you how to use these. They're really fun. Like I said, it gave me a little bit more inspiration in terms of cutting hair because, I've never seen it done. And it's just amazing, the outcome, right?
How many of you guys own a pair of tennis shears like that? With a little bit bigger of a guard than you might think you need to use, because you can always take more hair off. You can't put the hair back on.
All right, so this is the end result. Super easy, super simple. I just kind of wanted to teach you the basics, you know. Nice little high fade, pretty drawn out. I texturized the front. Got the base length in the front, married it into the back, everything 90 degrees. I left it kind of with a drop fade to arc above the ear and drop under the occipital area right here, just so I can line it up. And add a little bit of texture. Yeah, my name is Hope. I'm here on behalf of myself and Troy.
A little introduction about myself. My name is Anthony Mercado. On social media, I go by Fade Master. I've been cutting hair for professional license for a little over 10 years. I started cutting hair when I was 12, and it's been something that I've been doing ever since. Today, what I'm going to be demonstrating and teaching you guys, what I like to do is like freestyle designs, and like a little texture and crop top is like the new style that's been getting very trendy and a lot of clients have been asking for. So, and this is my brother. A lot of people don't know it's the same mom, same dad.
Real brother. Hey, how's it going? My name's Edward. Some people know me by Edward Clipperhands on Instagram. Today I'll be demonstrating. I never cut his hair. It's the first time I'm gonna cut it, so I wanted to check it out. I see some dents, so today I'm gonna go ahead and do a little low fade, and show you guys how I do my faded beard. So hopefully you guys take some notes and take those back to the shop. We're out here to grill together. Let's do this. I got one attachment on there, the wall. I'll open it up to 1.5. Right now what I'm gonna do, I'm just clean up off this excess weight before I begin my first technique.
Anybody got any questions so far? Anybody got questions about anything? He's closing it. He said he opens it about 1/2 inch, and he closes it. And he goes up just a little bit at the line where he sees the line. He's hitting and flicking off. Gotta remember that the clippers are pretty much an eraser, so you're erasing the line. So if you What are you looking for right now? You're giving them a good look. What are you looking for?
Now I'm gonna go line up the bottom. I'm just, I know I'm
look and make sure everything's straight. See, if you see, like, the hair was all like messed up, right? So what I do, at first I comb through it where I want it to lay. And once it lays down, what I do, I raise it up. With my hand, I just pretty much stop it and bend it. I bend it so it gives it that nice little comb look. And it gives it that nice curl.
Raising it and he's bending it. It gives him that nice pomp look. See the difference?
Come on, Marvin, get out of the way.
Just to give you a little background before I get started into my presentation, I started cosmetology school with my mom. Right out of high school, we went together, and it was kind of like embarrassing at first. You go to school with your mom. But it was kind of cool because I built a really good relationship with my mom through that experience. But while I was there, they asked me how I felt about it. And I went to cos school first because there was no barber schools in the area. And so in order for me to do what I wanted to do, I had to do what I didn't want to do. I really wanted to cut hair. That was it. Didn't matter how I was going to get there because I had to go to cosmetology school, which meant I had to do perms and do the little old ladies with the little perm rods. I had to do, I'm sure if she's smiling, that means she's done it. You know, I had to color hair, which was, at the time, not the most popular thing for me to want to do, but I did it because it was important for me to be able to cut hair. So while I was in school, the newspaper locally came in and said, you're the first mother and son duo at this school, and we want to interview you. And they asked me, what is it that you want to do? And first off, I said, I just want to cut hair. It's really simple. And when I'm done here, I'm going to go work at Champ Hall's Barbershop. When I'm done there, I'm going to open up my own barbershop. I'm going to get my teacher's license. And when I get my teacher's license, eventually I'm going to open up a school. So here we are 26 years later. I do own my own school. I have several shops. I have several barbers, 16 barbers, 2 stylists. And so that dream has finally come to fruition. And so what I want to talk today to you guys about is the evolution of entrepreneurship. Things are totally different now than what they were when I started in 93. So in 93, I got introduced to the barber game. I was the kid who was cleaning the windows and sweeping the floor and throwing out the trash. But from that time to now, it is totally, totally different. So I want to talk to you a little bit about that. And so I have a presentation and we'll be going through this presentation. I'm going to ask some people to do some things. As a matter of fact, let's get everyone real quick to stand up. Even the vendors, I need. When you tried to crisscross your hands, it was like, wait, anybody felt like it was a little bit different? Right. So sometimes you're going to be asked to do something that might feel a little bit different. Just because it's different and it may feel a little bit awkward doesn't mean that it's not good. And so that was the purpose of that exercise. I'm going to walk you through some things as we go through this presentation. So this is the presentation. I'm Tyree Jackson, and what I talk about here is the evolution of entrepreneurship for a lifetime. And so to get started, a lot of people are like, I go live every Tuesday at 9:30 a.m. And I'll put it back up afterwards. But a lot of people ask me, hey, Tyree, how do you start a brand? If you walk around the room, we got Tori Hanzo, we got Gentleman's Republic, we got The Spot, we got Zeus, Tiffany in the back braiding hair, but nobody knows that. Somebody wants your hair braided, Tiffany can braid your hair in the back, right? There you go. So we got some food. You see 210 hair masters with the hair grippers. We have Barber Society, Orange County Barber. So each person here has a brand. If you look around, a lot of time we're like, how do I start my brand? And I'm sure you guys are on social media. You see everyone has a pomade. Everyone has a wax. Everyone has a gel. And everyone is trying to do something with that brand. And so it's like, how do I start my own brand? So we're going to talk a little bit about branding. And if you understand anything about branding, there are different things that are really, really important with that. One is most people say, hey, Tyreek, check my logo out. How's my logo look? Can my logo look cool? Do you like it? Do you like my logo? Do you like my logo? What about it? I'm like, I don't know. What does it do? And I'm going to be honest with you. Your logo doesn't really mean anything until it actually creates the value. For example, you have a pin on, right? And this pin right there, it says Barbers. Was that a good one? That was good, right? Barbers. That was good? Okay. So, but the pin says
says barbers. And so when you read that with the explosion, every single one of you that are following It's Marvy Marv already knows what that pin signifies. Because the pin now has some value to it. That the lettering, the explosion, you know what it means just by looking at it. When you look at this logo right here, what do you think about? Mickey Mouse. And where are we at? Right, we're in Anaheim, but what's right around the corner? Disneyland. So look, I got to take my family to Disney World in Orlando, Florida. So I got memories from that. And so, you know, there's a different importance as to what Mickey Mouse means to me and my family. And so at one point, you know, you take anybody, any kid that doesn't speak, they know what McDonald's is when they see it. Am I right or wrong? Right? If they're Spanish, they'd be like, papas, papas, they got papas. I want french fries. Right? Everybody knows what I'm talking about. Even if you don't speak, kids know what that means because it has some significance. They know that they can go and get French fries. Does this make sense? So it has some value as to what it is. The Nike sign, very iconic. It actually means victory. You see it, it's the Nike swoosh. But the swoosh didn't mean anything until it created value. You had athletes, it was actually track stars that wore them, and they made waffles. I had a waffle maker that made the rubber for the shoes, and they made shoes very, very light, if you understood the story behind Nike and how they started. But what did they do? Eventually, after a while, they started to build other brands. What's their slogan?
Just do it.
Just do it. Everybody knows their slogan. So it's really, really important that now that has an association with the actual icon. And so we know who this is, right? Yeah. Who's that? The GOAT. I don't care what anybody says, he's still the GOAT. I know you're a LeBron fan, but it doesn't matter. The GOAT. So the thing about this is this. When was this symbol created, though? What did you say? Nike kind of created, but when did it start? Because Michael Jordan came out. If y'all had the retro ones, they were just Nikes. Right? What, say that again? 85. What happened in 85? It was the dunk competition when he jumped from the foul line and he had his tongue out, and then they created this iconic symbol. So now you know it, and then people, they spend all their money, work all weekend so they can go out and get the retro Jordans. Apple, we all know, we have devices, it's on the back of our phones. What does this symbol mean? Let me tell you how it started. They were Macintosh computers. And so what happens is a lot of times we want to tell people what we think we are and not believe what people say we are. For example, if I go to you, you came up to me and said, Tyree Jackson, right? And I said, yeah, he probably doesn't know me. He doesn't know anything about me, right? And then he says, well, who is that guy? What is that? And then what you're going to say to him is what I may have been to you. Oh, I watch him. I see him on Tuesdays. He does this talk. It's awesome, blah, blah, blah. And then he goes, oh, okay, cool. I got it. I know. But if you say, oh, he's a butthead. I tried to take a picture with him, and he didn't take a picture of me. He sucks. That's the most important part of the conversation. It doesn't matter that I come up here and say, hey, I am Tyree Jackson. I do a live talk. I do this, I do that, blah, 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 blah. I travel. It doesn't matter. What matters is what you're going to say to the next person. Does this make sense? So we're all talking about your brand, what your brand represents, what it means, what people understand your brand to be. And a lot of that comes from the narrative that is created from that. So, Apple, the reason why they call it Apple is because at some point, the Apple computer created these cool fonts, and they were in the office building, but everyone had the PCs. And so whenever you needed something printed in color and had all the cool stuff, the fonts with it, they say, hey, go print it on the computer that has the Apple on it. So now we don't call them Macintosh computers. Say, I use my Mac, but it's a what computer? An Apple. We identify it by the symbol. So the symbol actually has some significance. And the reason I'm bringing this up is, does anyone know what Toucan Sam is? Toucan, a bird? Toucan Sam, what's Toucan Sam?
It's a cartoon
toodle
or
the whatever. The cartoon from Fruit Loops, all right? So there's a thing about the toucan. The toucan originally lived in the wilderness, and what they did is they ate bugs. And so their beaks looked pointy, so they can go in and eat bugs. But as there was a drought through evolution, they moved into the rainforest, and now they would eat fruit. And so their beaks had to adapt and change so they can survive. So it was important to be able to, for the toucan to survive. And so whether you believe in evolution or not, this animal, this bird, this fowl, in order for it to survive, it had to adapt to a new environment. A computer that I was doing a lot of that on, and it died. It died. It completely died on me. So I went and contacted PayPal. They offered me a $9,000 loan. What did the bank look like before? I had to go to the bank. I got to shake some guy's hand. I put my best suit on, right? I got to have a business plan and say, here's my business plan. Can you lend me $9,000? And they say, fill out this information. We're going to do this. And we're going to send you a letter in the mail. Only to get a letter that comes back and says what?
No.
Loan denied. With PayPal, when you're using it and you're streamlining your money, meaning I'm always using that same resource, what happens is I went and I asked one time, I just went, I didn't, I was naked on the toilet. I was on the toilet naked. Let me fill out a PayPal thing because I need a new computer. I didn't want to take my hard-earned money. But what I do is I have those $5 payments that come in every time somebody books an appointment. And I don't even cut their hair. They're just paying $5. Thank you. I appreciate you guys for paying $5 for this appointment. I took that money, and because I'm streamlining that income, what I did was I contacted PayPal, one email, filled out the information. They said you're eligible for $9,800 of a PayPal loan. I didn't even take the whole thing. I went and bought two computers. One that I can carry and one for my video editing guy to do what he does. And it also helps his business because I'm investing in him. But it didn't cost me anything. So every time somebody sends me a $5 payment, $1.30 goes towards the loan. I didn't go beat somebody. The bank says no. PayPal says yes, because you're using our money. I know you're making money off of us, so sure, I'm going to give you a loan. Does this make sense? You guys need to think a little bit differently. We talked about crisscrossing your hand. We talked about the toucan, the old environment. We talked about the TV. We're not marketing that way anymore. So finances are extremely important, and you need to be aware of it. Guys, this was a lot of my presentation. But before I go, is there anyone that has any questions about anything that I said? Yes, sir.
What was the brand of
it's on Instagram. Effects Apps on Instagram. Now, here's the deal. He doesn't pay me. This is not a paid advertisement for that. But this guy, in the last 3 years, anyone guess what I made in the last 3 years off of $5 payments? Take a number. Yes. 50, Jesus, please, Lord, I'm ready for it right now. So no, that's good, but no, I actually made $90,000 in 3 years off of $5 payments. 90 grand, 3 years, $5 payments, no haircuts done. They just told you. You said two payments came in while you're recording. You said a couple payments came in. Those are people scheduling appointments, and I'm here. You understand what I'm saying? The power of technology. It's not what technology does. It's what you do with technology. I showed you how to use a light. Was that helpful? Now, you got to mess with it a little bit. And I did it with a cell phone. Can you imagine if I used an expensive camera, different quality photo with a $20-$30 light. You understand what I'm saying? I showed you how to utilize technology. I'm not a photographer, but I'm becoming one because I'm using technology. Does this make sense? I told you how to market yourself using technology by digitally tapping people. If you're in the shop cutting hair, you go take a picture, you can just start liking a lot of people. At the Starbucks, does this make sense? I want those people to come to my business and spend money. I don't care if it's a girl. My timeline sucks. Sometimes I got this cat. I don't even like cats. Cat shows up, I just like it, because hopefully she's got a boyfriend, right? And he comes and gets a haircut. You understand what I'm saying? It doesn't matter. I'm engaging with somebody that I don't know instead of liking barbers all over the country that really aren't going to come and get a haircut. Now, from your personal page, like and follow who you like. If they're inspiration, I want you to follow me, but I would rather you follow me from your personal page, not your business page. Does this make sense? Because what I want to see on your timeline is people who are going to come and spend money with you. Does that make sense? Do we have any more questions? Because I know you guys want to battle. Yes.
Geotag,
yep, real simple. As a matter of fact, open your phone.